Okay, good morning everybody. My name is Rupa, working as assistant professor in Chevrolet Engineering College. I'm dealing the subject power electronic controllers and drives for the JNTUK R16 batch 3rd triple SEM2, and this is unit 1. Topic is multi quadrant operation. This is lecture 5. So now we will go into multi-quadrant operations. So there are different types of operations the drive will be operating. Out of them, we are having four types of four-quadrant operations. So before going to that four types of operations, first we will learn the basics. So first basic is about the motor speed. See, if the motor speed is taken as positive, it is assumed to be in forward direction. And what is the second assumption of the motor speed is, if there is only one speed for the motor direction, it is taken in forward normal direction. And if the motor speed is in upward motion, it is also taken in forward direction. And for acceleration, positive rate of, this is acceleration means positive rate of change of speed. This is taken in forward direction. And for deceleration, it is quite opposite to acceleration, negative rate of change of speed. So it is taken in reverse direction. Actually, motor will be operating in two modes. What are the two modes? First one is motoring. First one is motoring and second one is braking. Okay, so see here, both these motoring and braking operations, both these motoring and braking operations will be operating again in two types of directions. So motoring will be operating in forward direction and reverse direction. And again, braking is also operated in forward direction and reverse direction. So totally there are possibilities of four directions. Motoring forward direction, motoring reverse direction, and braking forward direction and braking reverse direction. Okay, so now we will see about these four types of quadrants. So these are called as quadrants, right? These are called as quadrants. So see here, these are the four types of quadrants. Motoring electrical energy, for motoring electrical energy is converted into mechanical energy. In previous classes, this is over, but for basic purpose, I am again revising. And for braking, mechanical energy is converted into electrical energy, right? So these are the four types of quadrants: first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant, and fourth quadrant. Okay, so these are the names of the quadrants: first quadrant forward motoring and second quadrant forward braking. So first two quadrants are given as forward motoring and braking. So see here, 1 and 3 are given motoring operations, and 2 and 4 nothing but generator operations, braking operations. 2 and 4 are given braking operations. So now we will go through different quadrants. See here. So quadrant 1. So if you observe here, quadrant 1 here, it is forward motoring quadrant. So the developed power here is positive. So if the developed power is positive, what will happen? Machine will be acting as a motor and it supplies mechanical energy. So this is called as forward motoring. Okay. So as the power is positive, we are taking forward for positive. Always forward means positive. Okay, so as the power developed here is positive, the motor acts as a motor. So mechanical energy is given. And coming to the second quadrant, here the power is also positive. Okay, but the machine will be working under braking. This braking will be opposing the motion. So what is the normal motion of the motor? What is the normal torque of the motor will be opposed. So this is called as braking. So that's as the power is forward, this is called as forward braking. Okay, next coming to the third quadrant, third and fourth quadrant, these are reverse motoring and reverse braking. So here power will be negative. So in third quadrant, it is taken as reverse motoring. Motoring operation will be done in third quadrant. So power is negative. And here also power will be negative. And it is operating as reverse braking. So reversely, it is opposing the motion. So this quadrant operation can be explained briefly by taking an example, by taking the operation of the hoist. This is the hoist and we are taking the example of this hoist operation, how the hoist will be operated in 1, 2, 3, 4 quadrants. Okay, so see here, this is a hoist. This will be containing a rope wound on the drum coupled to the motor shaft. This will be wound on the drum and coupled to the motor shaft. Okay, so one end of the rope will be tied to the cage, which is used to transport. This is the transportation cage. So if you want to transport any material, you have to put it in the empty cage and we have to transport it to some declination, some area or some level or some other level. Okay, so one level to other level, the transportation of men or material will be done by this empty cage. And this is the other rope. The other rope of this has counterweight. So opposite to the empty cage, it is having counterweight. So if the weight of the counterweight is greater than the weight of the empty cage, it is nothing. See here. If the counterweight is loaded to some value, always the counterweight will be constant. In all the four quadrants, the counterweight will be constant. So, and if the empty cage is loaded fully, the counterweight is lower than the empty cage. Okay. So, the counterweight weight is lower than the empty cage full weight. Understood? If I loaded the empty cage fully, then it is more weight than the counterweight. Okay, so the forward direction of the motor speed means it is nothing but moving upward of the cage. If the cage is moving upward, then it is taken in forward direction. If the cage is moving downwards, then it is taken in reverse direction. Okay, so see here, positive load torque is opposite sign to positive motor torque. Remember this point, it is used in further definitions and further operations. Positive load torque. See, if the positive load torque exists, it will be opposite sign to the positive motor torque. Okay, and if you take the equation 2, what is equation 2? T is equal to load torque. Motor torque is equal to load torque plus dynamic torque. In that, this torque will be, but the equation 2 will be plotted on the same axis only. Though it is taken as opposite, motor torque is taken as opposite to the load torque. Though it is taken in opposite sign, but it is plotted on the same axis. Okay, so if you draw a load torque curve, motor load and load torque curve, if you draw the curve in the above assumptions manner, it will be actually negative. You will get actually negative one. Okay, and gravitational torque sign does not changes with the direction of motor. Okay, we need not change the gravitational torque sign. Okay, now we will go through the load torques. See here, first I am considering 1 and 4. Okay, 1 and 4 quadrants. See here, 1 and 4 quadrants. 1 and 4. After that, I will be considering 2 and 3. Okay, so if you take first quadrant and fourth quadrant, these gives the speed torque characteristics for the loaded hoist. This is the loaded. This is the loaded hoist. This is the loaded cage. This is the loaded cage. And these two in second and third quadrants, these two are empty cages. In first and fourth quadrants, these are loaded cages. Okay, so there exists a difference. If the cage is loaded, there exists a difference of torques. Okay, so this counterweight torque is different to loaded cage count. Okay, so this torque will be different. The torques will be different. And if you take 2 and 3, this gives the speed torque characteristics for the empty hoist cage, which is difference of torques due to counterweight and empty cage. Okay, so here we have to take negative sign because counterweight is more than the empty cage because the cage is not loaded. This counterweight is more than the empty cages. So here we have to take negative sign and here we have to take positive sign. Okay, so first operation, quadrant one, operation in first quadrant. See here, in quadrant one here, this hoist requires movement of cage upwards. That is positive motor speed. Upwards means we have to take positive, but anti-clockwise direction. But anti-clockwise, the movement will be like this. The counterweight will be moving like this opposite, but anti-clockwise like this. Okay. So when both are in same load, when both are same loaded, there will be constant. If load cage is more weight than the counterweight, the counterweight will be moving upwards like this. Okay, so if it is moving, the drum will be moving like this. So the torque will be in anti-clockwise. So upwards means we have to take positive motor speed and anti-clockwise direction. So when the speed is in positive direction, the torque will be produced in positive direction but anti-clockwise. So this anti-clockwise torque, positive torque, is equal to the load torque. So it is positive power. So forward motoring will be occurring here. Okay. So as the empty cage is loaded, now the counterweight moves up. As the counterweight moves up, it will be, the drum will be moving in anti-clockwise. So torque will be in anti-clockwise. So this torque will be anti-clockwise. So TL will be opposite to TE, as I mentioned before. Motor torques and load torques are opposite in nature, but both will be positive. Okay, so motor produces positive torque in anti-clockwise direction, which is equal to the magnitude of load torque. Motor torque and load torque will be equal in magnitude, but opposite in direction. So the power producer is positive and the direction is taken as anti-clockwise. This is called as forward motoring. Okay, and next, coming to the fourth one, fourth quadrant. Okay, so here what happens? The cage, loaded cage weight is less. Counterweight is more weighted. Okay, opposite, quite opposite to this. Okay, so what happens? The loaded cage will be moving upwards. Okay, so when the loaded cage is lower and it is greater than the counterweight, the loaded cage will be greater than the counterweight. So it comes down due to gravity itself. So the counterweight comes down due to gravity itself. So to limit the cage within the safe values, motor will be producing positive torque, that is equal to again load torque, but in anti-clockwise direction. So power and speed both are negative here. So the drive will be reverse braking. Okay, so loaded cage is less than the normal here, normal weight, but it is greater than the counterweight. So loaded cage is more weight than the counterweight. Okay, so it is little bit more, that's why it comes due to gravity, it comes down, the counterweight comes down. Okay, next, second quadrant. See the second quadrant here. Here counterweight is more than the empty weight. Counterweight is more than empty cage. So empty cage is moved up. Empty cage is moving up as the counterweight is higher in weight. Okay, so to limit the safe to a, to limit the speed to a safe value, the motor produces braking torque TL2. So to while the motion is going on, while the moment is going on, to limit the speed within a safe value, the motor produces a braking torque which is equal to TL2, but this is in clockwise direction. This is taken in clockwise direction. T is taken in clockwise direction. So quite opposite, TL is an anti-clockwise direction. So here speed is positive and power is negative. Because it is clockwise direction, power is negative. So here forward braking will be occurring. And in third, last quadrant, see here, last quadrant, empty cage is less than counterweight. So it is lowered. Empty cage is less than the counterweight. That means counterweight is also more than the empty cage. So motor should produce a torque. Again, this will be in clockwise. So again, here also speed will be quite opposite. Speed is negative here. Power is positive here. So here speed is negative and power is positive. Okay, in second quadrant, what is the speed? Speed is positive here and power is negative here. Quite opposite. Speed is negative here, power is positive in third quadrant. Okay, so here reverse motoring will be occurring. So these are the quadrant operations. So now we will see about the last topic, braking, in the first unit, last topic, braking. So in motoring, as usual, the machine, the drive works as a motor. It converts electrical to mechanical energy in motoring. So while coming to the braking, it is just acting as a generator, right? The motor works as a generator, taking mechanical energy and convert it into electrical energy. So in the braking, motor mainly works as a generator and it develops negative torque which opposes the motion. Okay, so always in the braking position, it develops negative torque. This negative torque will be always opposing the motor torque, nothing but it is opposing the motion. So this opposition of this motion is explained in three types. This negative torque will be coming in three types. First one is regenerative braking. First one is regenerative braking and second one is dynamic or rheostat braking. Third one is plugging or reverse voltage braking. Okay, so first one, regenerative braking. So see here, actually generator energy is supplied to the source. So generator will be always supplying energy to the sources. Okay, so for this to happen, see here, the equivalent circuit, first see here, equivalent circuit. This is the figure of steady state equivalent circuit of armature. This is the main supply voltage. This is the EMF generated here, and this is the generator and resistance, some resistance, armature resistance. So in figure A, if the generator has to supply to the source, then which energy is more? E must be more than V, right? E must be more than V. So if we are getting some power from here to the source, then armature current will be reverse direction. So armature current will be in negative direction as compared to now. Okay, so here, what are the assumptions in figure? E should be greater than V, and IA will be negative, as E will be supplying energy to the source. Okay, so this figure is the regenerative braking characteristics of a separately excited motor. Okay, so here we cannot increase, field flux cannot be increased beyond the rated speed because of having saturations. Okay, so you know about saturation very well. Field flux cannot be increased beyond the rated speed because of saturations. So if you take according to the equation, see here, this is the regenerative braking characteristics. If you see here, if you take according to the equations, you will get E is equal to here EMF. E is equal to Ke phi omega m. And the equation 29. Okay, this is equation 29. Regarding these two equations, for the source, so for source to be, you have some assumptions. First one is the source should be a fixed voltage. The rated value, regenerative braking is possible only if speed is greater than the rated values. Okay, so here, what is the first condition for the source to be is it should be fixed voltage and it should be rated values. Because regenerative braking, this first braking called regenerative braking, is possible only when speed will be greater than rated values. Okay, and second one, if the source is variable source, then the speed will be less than rated values. Okay, so for fixed and rated values of source, the speed will be greater than rated values. And for second one, variable voltage, the speed will be less than rated values. Okay, so if you see in series motor condition, so what happens if speed increases? If speed increases, armature current increases. So as the armature current increases, what happens? Flux decreases because of demagnetization. So this is the equation 29, and this cannot be achieved. So regenerative braking is not possible in series motor. Okay, so see here, in series motor, speed will be increasing. When speed increases, it draws more current from the armature. So when it draws more current from the armature, effective losses will be more. So flux decreases. So equation 29 cannot be existing because as the flux decreases, EMF will be decreasing. So EMF will not be greater than voltage if it decreases. Right, so if EMF is not more than supply voltage, this equation is not applied. So regenerative braking cannot be applied for the series motor. So regenerative braking is possible only when loads are connected in line and power is equal to 2 or more than the regenerated power is there. Okay, so regenerative power is not applicable to the series motor. It is possible only when loads are connected in line and when the power is equal to 2 or more than regenerated powers. Okay, so suppose if load is less than regenerated power, what happens? If load power is less than regenerated power, then all the regenerated power is not absorbed by the loads. Okay, so if load power is greater than regenerated power, then all the regenerated power is absorbed by the loads and remaining power will be supplied to the capacitors in line. So we are taking in before point, as the induction motor works as a generator, there we are taking the capacitor bank, right? In previous classes we have discussed the induction motor, which is generalizedly working as a generator. Okay, in that we are keeping some active power is going to the supply from the generator, and the generator is taking away reactive power from the supply. Why it is taking reactive power from the supply? In order to produce the EMF, produce the flux. It is taking the reactive power and it is giving the active power. So if all the active power is given, and if you put some capacitors in the supply, what happens? The remaining power, other than the supply, the remaining power will be supplied to the capacitors in the line. Okay, so if this more power, if load power is greater, what happens? If it is supplied to the capacitor, line voltage will be increasing. So if line voltage increases to a dangerous value, there will be a insulation breakings. So for this, if the load power is less than regenerative power, all the regenerative power is not absorbed by the load. What happens if all the regenerative power is not absorbed by the load? The remaining regenerative power is supplied to the capacitors. So what happens if the capacitors draw that power? Voltage fluctuations will be more and there will be causing insulation breakdown. So for this we have to do some alternate arrangement. The alternate arrangement is done by diverting the excessive power to the resistance bank. Okay, so in that resistance bank, what happens? The power is allowed to flow to the resistance bank. So the remaining power is dissipated in the form of the heat in the resistance bank. So such a breaking means such a diversion of regenerative power to the resistances is called as composite breaking. Because it is a combination of both regenerative braking and dynamic braking. That's why it is called as composite braking. So when the source is equal to battery, then regenerated energy is stored in the battery. Okay, so if you are not interested in putting the resistances and dissipating the extra amount as heat, we can put the source as a battery and then recharge the battery, because the regenerated power will be stored in the batteries. Okay, this is regenerative braking. And next one is dynamic braking. So see here, the motor armature is disconnected from the source. Armature of the motor is disconnected from the source and it is connected across the resistance RB. Okay, so it is, see here, you can see the diagrams of separately excited and series. Okay, so this is normal motoring connections of the separately excited motor, and these are the braking connections. And this is the series motor, and these are the braking connections. See here, the motor armature is disconnected from the source. Actually, this motor will be connected to the source VF. Okay, but it is disconnected from the VF and it is connected across the resistance RB here. In both the cases, across the resistance RB, in separately and in series. Okay, so what happens if the motor is connected to resistance RB? What is the main aim of connecting this? Because the generated energy is dissipated in RB and armature resistance RA. Okay, so what is the main aim of connecting this motor across the RB? Means the generated energy is dissipated in RB and RA. RA is armature resistance. Okay, so this series Suppose if you take a series one, this series machine works as a self-excited generator. So field connections will be reversed as it is having residual magnetism. Field connections are reversed due to residual magnetism. So if you want for fast braking, if you want any fast braking, this RB should have small few sections. Because as the speed falls, sections are cut out to maintain high average torques fastly. Okay, and separately and shunt. For separately or shunt, the braking should be connected as separately excited generator or self-excited shunt generator. And in the field winding, we have to put this field winding parallel with armature because phi is constant. Okay, so for separately and shunt motors, what is the braking connections? Is braking should be connected either as separately or self-excited shunt generator. And we have to put the field winding in parallel to the armature. Because phi is constant, we have to put this field winding parallel to the armature. And here, separately excited. Separately excited, alternately connected as separately excited can be also connected as self-excited generator like this. Okay, so this is separately excited one and this can also be connected as self-excited generator like this. For braking only, separately excited will be connected like this. Okay, so when we are working with the separately excitation, the speed torque are calculated from the equation 30. Before I discuss the equation 30, and if you put V is equal to 0 in that equation 30, see here, I will show you equation 30 here. So see, this is the equation 30. So for separately excited one, the torque speed characteristics are calculated from this equation 30 and we have to put V is equal to 0 in this 30 equation. So how the equation 30 is obtained? See here from figure A, we can write the equation 30 like this. This is the equation 30 and I can write the equation 30 by this procedure. So you know that T is equal to K into IA. So E is equal to K into omega m. Omega